Greetings and welcome to a spooky Halloween episode of Genre Grinder that I didn't think was going to end up getting finished by Halloween, but assuming I do edit it in time, it will. I'm your host, Gabe Powers, and with me today is the incredible edible Patrick Ripoll.
That's what they tell me.
That was just off the top of my head. I'm so clever.
Absolutely.
I didn't write any of that down. Patrick of Tracks of the Damned and occasionally Director's Club podcast. Hello, Patrick.
Hey, how's it going?
Official greeting and all that. We're going to be doing another sort of marathon thing here, but not nearly as big as when we did the 1981 slasher movies, and especially not as big as when we tried to cover every single shot on video horror movie.
Oh, God.
This will at most end up being two episodes, but I'm really aiming for one here. And we are covering the what I think is the most great and important year in horror movie history, 1960. And it, you know, we looked through this, I sort of measured out how many movies I personally liked and how many movies I thought were important that came out each year. And 60 just sort of works, also because of when it lands in the era. Years that come very close are 1932, which had Dr. X, Freaks, Island of Lost Souls, The Mummy, The Old Dark House, Vampire with a Y, and White Zombie. And then 1964 has At Midnight I'll Take Your Soul, The Castle of Blood, The Comedy of Terrors, Mask of the Red Death, The Long Hair of Death, Onibaba, The Pit and the Pendulum, and 2000 Maniacs. All very good movies. Only one of those I would consider particularly groundbreaking. Then 1968 is the big one, which is Night of the Living Dead, Rosemary's Baby, Witchfinder General, Goki the Body Snatcher, Rape of the Vampire, Kurienko, Hour of the Wolf, Brides of Blood, and Spirits of the Dead.
And Targets.
And Targets. Oh, I forgot.
Which Letterboxd does not list as horrors for some reason. Oh. I mean, I understand why, but let's be real.
Yeah. And it also had Sweet Body of Deborah, which is not the first giallo, but it was one that was a pretty big hit early on and kind of set that up too. And then 1973 had Don't Look Now, The Exorcist, Sisters, Flesh for Frankenstein, Ganja and Hess, The Wicker Man, Theater of Blood, and Messiah Evil. Again, great movies, but I only like one or two of those feels like the first of their kind of important situation. So I compiled a list that, as usual, I will link in the description of 32 horror movies released in the year 1960. And we are aiming to cover six of them. One we are not covering because we assume you all know about it, but that we will be talking about is Alfred Hitchcock's Psycho, which is, I don't know, one of the top 10 most important horror movies ever made. But because it was so big, it overshadowed a lot of these movies that didn't get discovered again until like the video era. So I think Patrick had a kind of a setup here for how we kind of got to 1960, if you want to.
Yeah, yeah. In doing Tracks of the Damned, I've sort of researched the history of the horror market, particularly in America. And I have sort of come with a very abridged, brief, and extremely American-centric history of the horror film up to 1960. And the films we're going to be talking about from 1960 are from all sorts of different countries.
Right.
But my area of expertise is American. And I still think because America is such a big market, it mostly applies even for other films such as Black Sunday that weren't made in America, like City of the Dead or Black Sunday. So,
right. Right.
Basically, the real first horror boom starts in 1930 when the success of the Dracula stage show led Universal to produce a film version. And then so that started the first industry horror boom, which went through the mid-30s. This is the pre-code era of horror. And the thing about pre-code is it's especially nasty. It's especially ghoulish. It's especially sexual. And it was especially objectionable by England, who enacted very strict censorship laws on film at this time. And because England was such a huge market, it's the other big English-speaking sort of country that these films were being exported to, they basically had – Hollywood had to adjust what they were doing and sort of moved into softer sci-fi kind of fare. You get stuff like Night Key and The Invisible Ray is the one I was trying to think of, like that are, they're still kind of sci-fi horror movies, but they're a lot more about special effects and stuff. Night Key's not a sci-fi horror movie, but it's certainly a sci-fi movie that was marketed that way. At any rate, that goes until about 1938 when Emile Heumann, who is a film exhibitor, put together a horror triple feature of Dracula, Frankenstein, and Son of Kong in the theater he owned in Hollywood. And it was so popular that Universal was like, oh, wow, people still really like those old horror movies. And they released 500 prints of Dracula and Frankenstein to sort of circulate world nationwide. And then they got to work on Son of Frankenstein, which was a long-awaited sequel to Bride of Frankenstein. And that started the next horror boom. Son of Frankenstein came out in 1939. And that horror boom went until the mid-40s. A lot of the mad scientist movies, a lot of the Universal Monster sequels, a lot of the sort of Poverty Row murder thrillers with Bela Lugosi all sort of come from that era. Now, exactly why it petered out, other than just people got sick of them, I can't say for sure. I do suspect that given the specific timing, once people really came to grips with the horrors of World War II, particularly the horrors of the Holocaust, I think a lot of the public's taste for the horror as a genre just kind of went out the window. And you kind of don't see many, if any, like horror movies coming out of Hollywood in the late 40s. Now, the 50s, there was a new boom of horror movies, and there were a couple things that set that up. One was that in 1948, there was a landmark case, United States versus Paramount Pictures, that led to an antitrust decision that said studios couldn't own their own movie theaters. They basically had to sell off all the movie theaters that they own. And now that movie theaters were run by these independent chains and stuff that weren't connected to the studios, there was more of an opening there for independent filmmakers to get their product on screens. The other thing that happened in the late 40s was that there was a really big boom in American car ownership, and that led to a boom in drive-in theaters. There were something like 3,000, 4,000 drive-in theaters by the early 50s in America. And because drive-in theaters were cheaper to maintain than traditional theaters, they were then for cheaper for audiences to attend. And that meant the requirements for profits there were lower. And that meant that the movies that played there didn't necessarily need to be quite as extravagant and star-driven. And so that's how you get a rise of a new scene of independent films about the mid-50s. Obviously, the most successful of these was AIP and Roger Corman, but there were plenty of producers who made two or three, you know, horror and sci-fi films each. Allied Artists released several. So most of the horror films of the 50s were of a sci-fi nature. And there were two films particular, or there were 2 years particularly that inspired that. One was 1951, which was the year that The Day the Earth Stood Still and The Thing from Another World came out. And that's how you get sort of the 50s alien invasion movies. Right. And then in 1953, you get Beast from 20,000 Fathoms, which was the Ray Harryhausen special stop-motion dinosaur attacks the city movie. And that was the thing that inspired the giant monster trend of the 50s. And pretty much every horror film that you would see in the 50s would be in one of those two sci-fi lanes. And they became popular again. And in 1957, that was really the pivotal year that signaled a shift, because that was the year that there were 14 giant monster movies in theaters in America. 15, if you count The Incredible Shrinking Man, where he shrinks down and has to battle giant animals or animals that are giant to him. And once after 1957, the fad kind of slowly died off over the next couple of years. People just kind of got their fill of someone filming a tarantula climbing over a photo of a building. 1957 also was the year that the Shock Theater Package came to TV. And the Shock Theater Package was a Screen Gems, which was a television subsidiary of Columbia Pictures. It was a Screen Gems package of 52 classic Universal horror and mystery films that were released for television syndication. So these are the films from the first and second horror booms that we talked about from the 30s and 40s. And that kind of exposed all of these classic monsters and classic horror movies to a new generation. It directly led to both the creation of the TV horror host, because all these different channels had identical films and they wanted to stand out. So that's how you get the guy doing weather to put on a Dracula cape and be funny as he, you know, introduces the mummy. And that's also where you get the magazine Famous Monsters of Filmland. And all of this right here is the people call the monster kid trend of these baby boomers who were sort of enriched in all of this horror culture. And it became sort of this permanent market, not just for these baby boomers, but for all kids and teenagers and adults and stuff to follow. Most importantly, though, 1957 was the year that Curse of Frankenstein was released by England's Hammer Studios.
I knew that was coming.
Yeah, Curse of Frankenstein was a total groundbreaking horror film. It is one of those things, kind of like Psycho, less influential specifically as a film than Psycho, but it is one of those things where there was nothing really like it before. And then after, there was a lot like it, because it had all this shocking violence and it had, you know, it had literal gore. You saw like severed hearts and stuff being dipped into acid baths and things of that nature, because it was this really shocking sci-fi horror, and it was in really beautiful color. And it had production values that you don't associate with, especially the horror films of the earlier booms. But even in the 50s, they, you know, it was rare that they had this sort of lavish production on a gothic shocker. And from 1957 on, like I said, there were no gaps. There were different trends. There were different subgenres. There were different movies that became successful and everyone rushed to rip off. But pretty much from 1957 to today, there have always been horror movies.
Correct.
And so that was sort of the atmosphere that 1960 came from.
Yeah, and the reason 57 is obviously another very important year, but there weren't other movies like The Curse of Frankenstein that year. It had to take some time for them to get going. And that's what makes 60 sort of unusual, is that all of that trend sort of hit all these countries all at once. And we ended up with all these really great movies that then were really influential in their own way and end up having quite a bit in common, as we'll see as we go through them.
Yeah. And I do want to say that it isn't just horror films that, you know, Curse of Frankenstein didn't come out of nowhere. The late 50s were a time that across the world, taboos were being broken on the film screen, not just in terms of violence, but in terms of sex. You had like a film like Louis Malle's The Lovers in 1959, I want to say, that had, I forget the name of the actress, topless in it briefly, and it got brought up in obscenity charges in the United States, and the Supreme Court justice said the famous line, I can't define pornography, but I know it when I see it, and this is not pornography. And that sort of opened the doors for there to be nudity on American screens without, you know, the fear of cops busting in and seizing all the film reels, which still happened in certain markets. But so there were lots of Swedish films that would have these sort of laxer ideals of sex and nudity and things like that. There were nudie cuties happening in the late 50s to early 60s.
The varieties.
Thing.
And then I would say that the part where horror starts to connect to that is that then you had roughies, which were sort of like violent sexploitation movies that sort of feed into what came after 1960 as far as horror. Because you have another big shift is 63 with Herschel Gordon Lewis's Blood Feast, which is a movie made specifically just to be boobs and gore, basically. I guess there's no nudity in it, but there's a lot of near nudity.
Right. And I think that is one of the things we're going to see in these films is a linking of sexual titillation and violence. And certainly it's not that before 1960 that didn't happen, but I think that producers were very excited to push the boundaries and to give audiences exactly what they wanted. And the exploitation market had been doing that for a while, but they had been doing it in terms of like, oh, it's a juvenile delinquent film where all the girls wear really tight sweaters. You know, it wasn't quite heaving bosoms and stuff like that.
Or bikini dance shit.
That was late 50s as well, was the beginning of the sort of beach movie.
It's actually an era that I'm not particularly well versed in because I don't like a lot of it personally. I think it's a certain flavor that is very specific, that 50s exploitation flavor. You got to respect it, but it's never been one of my favorites.
if it hits me in the right way, I really do enjoy it. I really do enjoy those kind of AIP, drag racing movies and things of that nature. Oh, and then also in Hollywood, 1960 was sort of the year that the Hays Code officially died, where there were just several independent producers who just sort of gave the middle finger to it, and they released films like Anatomy of a Murder, and I think what's the film with Shirley MacLaine, where with the lesbian overtones.
Well, was that also the year that Man with the Golden Arm came out?
Man with the Golden Arm was like the year before, and that was United Artists decided to just say, well, rather than go for a Hays Code thing, we're just going to release it.
I just looked it up. That was 55. Holy crap.
That was, United Artists really left the MPAA for a while for that, and then they came back. So people had already sort of been testing things, and it was clear that audiences could handle it. And, Hollywood felt it had sort of outgrown the fear of – it was no longer a new industry, and they weren't really afraid of congressional sort of censorship. Mm-hmm. So they after the landmark case about Louis Malle's The Lovers, like they were – sort of ready to say, well, we don't need the Hays Code anymore. Anything goes. But that isn't really until the 70s where you actually get Hollywood films with casual nudity and, a lot of swearing and stuff. They sort of had to test the waters for a decade there.
Yeah. And it's just cool also for people like me with obsessive compulsive disorder that it happened to land on an exact 1960, even zero. It's
I'm glad you have that.
Yeah, it's like if it would have been like again 1968, vital year for horror movies, but 68, it's not as interesting of a number anyway.
God forbid we have an important film year that ends with a 3.
Yeah. Fuck that.
Yeah.
The least important number. So like I said, I have a list of 32 movies here. We're going to cover 6 plus talk about Psycho a bunch. And we're going to go in release order, which might surprise you. I know it surprises me when I look at it, but the first one here is Georges Franju's Eyes Without a Face, which is predating Psycho by quite a few months. And also a psycho thriller horror movie with weird stuff in common with it. It's about a man whose daughter is injured in a car accident with her face basically destroyed, and he and his assistant are kidnapping women cutting off their faces and trying to graft it onto his daughter, who and then, of course, they aren't necessarily trying to kill the women, but the women always die of complications or suicide or something as it goes on.
I mean, they're not getting volunteers. They're kidnapping them. I feel like the implication is the best case scenario that could happen for these women is that they'd be forever prisoners. So probably they would they were figuring on kill. They were disposable, let's say.
Yeah, exactly. And it's one of those movies that like a lot of movies on this list, it is considered in the year 2021, this artistic masterpiece. But when it was released, there were plenty of people who thought it was exploitation garbage because it was really gory and seedy and just upsetting to people. And I think that's what makes this one of my favorite, maybe my favorite of all the movies we're going to talk about. Now my second favorite of all the movies we're going to talk about is because it has that, Franju has this thing that is very Fritz Lang-esque, where he can make really classy and really seedy things kind of hold together in a way that you're not sure. Like it's like an art film, but also a socially irresponsible movie. And where I don't think Psycho falls under that. I think Psycho is an entertainment film with artistic ambition, but I think Psycho is really perfected and prepared and precise. Whereas this just feels more like they're willing to just do some wacky shit.
Like the reason Eyes Without a Face is a great film is because of the segments where the plot kind of just falls off to the side. Mm-hmm. And we're sort of encouraged to delve into something more strange and poetic.
Right. Franju, I should say it really does make me think of Fritz Lang movies. And I should say that Franju went on to make a very M-like movie called Spotlight on a Murderer, and then a very Dr. Mabuse-like movie called Judex. So I think that Lang is sort of in the back of his head when he's making these movies. A lot of critics I've read compare him to Jean Cocteau's work, but I only know the 46 Beauty and the Beast. So yeah. I'm not sure. For all I know, it could be a satire of his work, the artisticness in his work. Because there is a sort of funny slant, like dark comedy slant to Eyes Without a Face that's pretty easy to overlook because it's sarcastic at best, you know?
Well, it does the thing that it is absolutely playing with tropes, with like mad scientist tropes. Mm-hmm. It's a sort of a story structure that had appeared earlier in Italy with E. Vampiri. Mm-hmm. You said you had a list of movies that were sort of this rough plot.
Yes, I do actually. Hold on, let me scroll down here. It was one of those things where when you see a movie and then you realize it was like another movie you saw, and then suddenly you realize, wait, that was also like another movie, so you have to figure out which was the first. So Jesus Franco, while he was still in Spain before he ran away because Spain was a dictatorship, he directly remade this as the awful Dr. Orloff, Gritos in la Noche, in 1962, and then again as Faceless in 1988, a sort of slasher movie version. And then he made a Dr. Orloff spin-off sequel called The Diabolical Dr. Z. Then you got, much later, you got Pedro Almodovar's The Skin I Live In, which is a huge...
That's a direct homage.
Yeah, it's basically just the whole point of the movie is to be an homage to Eyes Without a Face. It has other point, I guess, but yeah, it's just incredible how it's not the same story, but it's like, it's definitely an updating of it. There's a super sleazy Peter Cushing thriller called Corruption by Robert Hedford Davis from 1968, where he has, instead of faces, he's killing women for their glands, pituitary gland, I think it is, and injecting him into a stripper that he's in love with. So the woman's sort of the villain in that case. Then there is, in the same year, in fact, only a couple months later, there's an Italian film by Anton Guido Margiano called Atomic Age Vampire, which is also about a stripper injured in a car accident. So they've already started to make it sleazier. And a mad scientist develops a serum that requires him to kill innocent women and give it to her. And then the weirdest one is that there's a movie that by Joseph Green that is pretty famous for Mystery Science Theater 3000 episode called The Brain That Wouldn't Die, about a man who's trying to replace his beheaded fiance's entire body after she's been decapitated from a car accident and killing women to steal their bodies. But the weird thing about that is that movie was shot in 1959 and not released until 62. So it wasn't ripping off Eyes Without a Face, and Eyes Without a Face wasn't ripping it off. It's just this weird coincidence that they happened to land on the same basic thing. There is a book that Eyes Without a Face is based on, but I couldn't even find an English language copy.
It's a French novel, so it was likely not translated at that point. And then this is I mentioned it earlier, Mario Bava's first film, E Vampiri.
Yeah.
It has roughly the same plot line as well, though it's just blood being drained. It's not like faces or pituitary glands or anything, but it is a scientist who's trying to like save his wife, I think.
It's sort of like this connection between mad scientist movies and slasher movies, or what would become slasher movies,
and like when you see the sort of the main mad scientist of Eyes Without a Face, unfortunately I can remember no character names, so when you see him, it is very much like, and this is the mad scientist of the movie. He's very like, he's not very warm, he's very cold, he's like, he's singularly obsessed with his work and shut off from humanity. And so the thing about Eyes Without a Face is it's sort of playing in these spaces, but the direction it goes every time just surprises you. Like, there's just a long passage where you see the supposed mad scientist like working with children and trying to actually help people, and it sort of complicates mm-hmm. your understanding of his relationship with humanity and stuff like that.
Right.
And of course the main image of the film that's the most famous is the, again, I can't remember character names. The woman is the young girl in the mask.
Edith Scobb's character. Yeah.
Yeah. She's wearing this sort of featureless mask. She doesn't have the benefit of, you know, that facial performance. And it's, instead of it being like, oh, but she still gets across exactly what she means through body language or something, the way some other, you know, people have played monsters under masks and stuff and still mm-hmm. gave in great meaning. For her, it's like purposefully it's just a blank, and the audience just projects so many things. And Franju just spends so much time just focusing on her face as if she was emoting. And then whatever the audience thinks she would feel at that point, that's what she's feeling. And it pokes at the audience because they're doing all the heavy lifting.
And it's also interesting because, again, I think that there is something tongue-in-cheek about it, I assume. But the first time you see her with the mask on, it's breathtakingly haunting. Like, it just, like, we know that there's something fucked up about her face, and we're not seeing it. We're not being shown it. The Alita Valley character, who is the assistant, hands her this mask, puts on her face, and the camera switches sides so we can see. And it's just so, so blank that it's freaky. And I get the feeling it's the kind of thing that, like, people gasped about when they saw it in theaters for the first time, because instead of being shown the gore that we're expecting, which we do see later, we're just shown this emptiness. And it's an image that other movies have sort of taken from. For me, I think that something about Mia Farrow's performance in Rosemary's Baby was informed by this. But I think everybody in the world seems to say that the Halloween mask, the Michael Myers mask, was sort of informed by how haunting the blankness is of this mask.
So I did some research into this. Mm-hmm. The thing about this film, like we said up top, was people were absolutely disgusted by it. Mm-hmm. There was a film critic who actually lost his job because he saw the movie for what it is, and he gave it a glowing review. And then his publication was like, oh, well, this guy's an idiot. We got to get rid of mm-hmm. him. It had an American release that was heavily edited, and it was, but it was like called The Horror Chamber of Dr. Faustus.
Right.
And it, by 1962, when that happened, at least some people were beginning to sort of see what was going on. Because they advertised it in America as being like a ghastly elegance that suggests Tennessee Williams, you know, one of the great horror classics. And it was on a double feature with The Manster, which was, let's say, not suggesting Tennessee Williams.
Yeah.
But it sort of went away real quick, and it really wasn't very widely remembered or thought of. It wasn't written about in books. When people were doing overviews of the genre, it wasn't considered one of the great films until Franju had a retrospective in Paris's Cinémathèque Française in 1986, and they showed it. And then people were really blown away by it. And then quickly it played at London's National Film Theatre. And this was 1986. And that was when people sort of began to reevaluate it. And it was remastered and had the first uncut American release in 2003. And so there is a 2003 interview with John Carpenter. It was one of the special features, I think, on like an Anchor Bay Halloween DVD.
Mm-hmm, one of the many.
Where they talked about the mask. He said, you know, it's possible I was inspired by this French film called Eyes Without a Face. And he goes, you know, it was very haunting. And he talked glowingly about the mask and that movie. And he goes, it's possible that was an influence. Mm-hmm. And of course, it's like he's saying that in retrospect in 2003,
right,
when the movie had just been released in America. Meanwhile, never before, and all the times people asked him about Halloween, did he bring up Eyes Without a Face?
Right.
But now if you go on to like IMDb trivia or whatever, people just say it was the inspiration for Michael Myers, which
right.
I probably they were just like, we this Captain Kirk mask isn't scary enough. What could we do? What if we made it more like a ghost? And they spray painted it white.
Yes. And so that's that assumption has been said so many times that even John Carpenter himself believes it now.
Right. Or he was just, you know, people ask you the same question a million times. You just start making stuff up.
Yeah.
John Carpenter doesn't strike me as being too afraid to do something like
no.
that.
No, he's, yeah. And I should, yeah, the violence is still reasonably graphic by our standards today. So you can see why there's a surgery scene that is disturbing because it's framed like surgery. It's not, there's no scary music. There's no cackling mad scientist. It's just a man cutting a woman's face off with a nurse assistant, like dabbing his forehead and handing him scalpels and stuff.
And it takes a while.
It's not short. And then when they pull the face off, it's sort of framed in a way where the severed face is still covering the gory bit, but not quite right. And it sort of feels like you're seeing something you're not supposed to see. Like the filmmakers meant to cover up the gore, but they're just fucking it up just a little. Oh no, I saw a little of it.
It fades to black, like, just a couple seconds later than you think it would.
Mm-hmm.
It's a really spectacular scene. The first time I ever saw this movie was part of a film marathon, and it was introduced as being like the first gore movie 3 years before Blood Feast. And obviously this movie has more going on than just being Blood Feast.
Right.
But like that was the thing I spent the movie waiting for. Right. I don't think I even appreciated how dreamy and interesting it is the first time. I was just like, oh boy, let's see that face come off.
And then later in the, after they've put the face on Eva's scab, it rots off again, which to me is the more disturbing thing.
Agreed.
Just the idea of getting skin graft is already upsetting for me. And then the idea that the skin graft doesn't take and part of you dies. Ugh.
Yeah, the realistic necrosis on the face is,
and it's only stills. It's not like it's not really presented. Again, it's presented scientifically. Like, mm-hmm. here's the failure.
So
it's not boom, boom, boom.
So Franju made a very well appreciated documentary about slaughterhouses before mm-hmm. this, and that was sort of more what the critics had thought of him, is like, oh yes, he's one of France's great artists. He's experimenting. He would mix footage of slaughterhouses with like footage of children, and he would shoot things in ways that it seemed slightly unreal. But of course, in the way that it was unreal, it was more disturbing. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of that in this, particularly in the way that those sequences play out. He has a quote. He says, Kafka becomes terrifying the moment it is documentary. In documentary, I work the other way around. And that was in an interview where he was talking about the slaughterhouse film, but clearly it also applies to this as well. Mm-hmm. So there's definitely some ambition there and some serious thought into the nature of subjectivity and objectivity and how audience perceives film in a way that certainly not a lot of people in this genre were thinking about at the time.
Yeah. And so I think that this movie, you can connect this movie to slashers and giallo. Psycho is one that everybody flat out quotes as being inspiration for slasher and giallo. But I think that there's something about Eyes Without a Face that has this sort of Euro sleaze thing that became much bigger as the decade went on.
I'll tell you one thing it has that Euro sleaze has. It has a soundtrack that you listen to it and you're like, this is really upbeat.
Yes.
this is not fit the tone of what I expect this material to have.
Well, and actually that was something I was going to talk about in a little bit, but I can mention now is that, part of the excitement for me in this movie is that Alida Valley is in it. And Alida Valley is this future baroness who's an Italian woman who, ended up working with basically every important, Italian director in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, Visconti and Bertolucci, Antonioni. But then she made these four cult movies. Well, maybe three cult movies and then a Hitchcock movie, the Paradigm Case in 47, Cale Reed's The Third Man, and Argento's Suspiria. And Argento's on record as referring to Eyes Without a Face is one of his favorite movies, and I actually believe him. I believe, unlike John Carpenter, this seems like a kind of movie Argento would have watched and had access to because his father was in the industry. And there's a lot here that that informs the way he dealt with Gialli. He wasn't the first one to have the black gloves, but he was taking that from Bava, but Bava was probably taking that from here with the black gloves and the black raincoat that Valley wears when she's kind of doing her murder stuff. Cause she's really the stalker of the movie. The doctor does the killing later, but she's the one who goes and gets people.
Yeah.
Anyway, I feel like those movies and this one, I all have this sort of post-World War II vibe. Like Paradigm Case is Hitchcock kind of finally moving beyond his paranoid war era movies. And he's about to start doing color movies like directly after this. There's this sort of post-Nazi mad scientist paranoia going on in here. And then in this movie, you're seeing this very blank French countryside that makes me think of Reconstruction, which is what Third Man is explicitly about. And then Suspiria was purposely set in Germany and includes famous Nazi landmarks in a way. Argento's sort of using it as a way to comment on the evil of that seeps into locations, because the school in Suspiria is evil itself. And I think that this is something that's just in my head, that all these things connect. But I feel like because of this, Alida Valley is the quintessential post-war actress. But the reason I bring this up from your point is that I think that her theme when she's walking around killing and gathering people, I think it's supposed to sound like Harry Lime's theme from The Third Man. It's the same instrumentation and stuff.
Yeah.
I couldn't find any information on it, but to me, it has that same bounciness. And I think it's even, they're even both zithers. If they're not, they're similar instruments. So I was zither.
You might be right there. Yeah.
And so it seems like the way people describe Franju's other movies being very quotey, that he might be quoting The Third Man, and that might have been why he hired her in the first place.
That makes sense to me. I would real quick say another obvious connection to Giallo is that specifically all of the victims, because of the plot of the movie, have to be beautiful young women.
Correct.
She's specifically trolling around to hear when there's a beautiful young woman who is vulnerable.
Because you need the pretty face. There's like a plot reason, which to me is
it's a little incestual.
Right. It's a little incestual, but to me also the having a plot reason why you have to only kill beautiful women is to me sort of sarcastic. And I could be reading into something that's not there, but there's something like acknowledging that pretty women are the one, even before this, were the ones who were mostly killed in horror movies. The idea that, well, here's the reason why it has to be a pretty woman just feels sarcastic to me. And it's something I enjoy about it. Again, Psycho being the movie that all the Giallo were trying to be, the connections to Psycho are interesting beyond the black and white photography. And it's the fact that they both have scenes of a woman on the lam driving out of town. In one case, she's trying to escape because she's stolen money. And in this case, she has a body in the back seat and she needs to get rid of. And both of them assume they're being caught at one point, but in one case the cop is just wondering what she's doing, and in the other case it's just a car trying to pass her. The fact that these two filmmakers came up with this very similar framing device and these long driving scenes set to really frantic music was a sort of strange coincidence. Driving, actually, like you mentioned, highways and cars becoming a bigger deal, and driving becomes a really several of these movies have driving as an important important component.
Yeah,
and highways and roads out of town in particular.
That's interesting. Yeah, I didn't think about that. I do want to make a real quick correction. I'm checking my notes here. The stuff I was saying about the critic being fired and the sort of universal disdain, that was Peeping Tom. Eyes Without a Face was very divisive, mm-hmm. But there were people who recognized at the time that it was sort of great. And in fact, in Cahiers du Cinéma, Michael Delahaye argued that it must be film noir instead of horror, because if it was horror, then it wouldn't be art. That right. was sort of the environment. Like, Diabolique had only come out a couple years earlier.
Correct.
And before that, there wasn't a lot of like French, what you would call like genre movies. France was known for being like high art, and they were very, the film industry was very proud of this. And this is sort of why Eyes Without a Face in France, like that's why Franju making this film at this time was such a provocation, was right. he was saying, no, horror is art as well. Or I see how a horror film could be art in a way that at the time people were not necessarily thinking about, you know, The Mummy or Frankenstein.
But at the same time, those people trying to cover up the horror thing do have a point in that there is something noir about this, and Psycho, and Peeping Tom, and then the Gialli coming out of this. It was the German creamy, I think is how you criminal movies, and these all informing the Gialli, but the Gialli that have this noir, like they all say they were Fritz Lang fans as well. So. Even though that critic was trying to say, well, no, like it's not horror because it wouldn't be art. He does have a point that noir crime movies did start to inform this stuff more around this time, and especially most of these aren't black and white, but this one and Psycho famously being black and white.
It's about half and half. City of the Dead also black and white. Black Sunday. By 1960, film noir was not really still a thing. Right. Its influences had sort of seeped into everything, and just in general, the photography of, you know, Hollywood films just sort of digested that, and the specific tropes of those stories and those characters and themes and stuff sort of went away. But it is worth noting that the 50s were a time when a lot of horror movies were contemporary films for the first time, or not for the first time, but a lot of, like, in the 40s, a lot of films that were contemporary still had to try to, like, keep their foot in the gothic. It would be like an old spooky house, even though if they drove a car there instead of, you know, taking a horse and buggy. In the 50s, because they were explicitly technological horror films, they were extremely modern and took place in modern spaces with modern characters. And here we have a film that takes place in, you know, a modern setting. Obviously Psycho, Peeping Tom, and City of...
Jigoku, too, is an important one.
That's right, Jigoku. I always forget Jigoku because I only remember the part.
We'll get into why you only remember half of Jigoku. But yeah, Jigoku would have been a big deal, too, because there was a lot of period stuff at the time in Japan too.
So yeah, Eyes Without a Face is a spectacular film. I will say, speaking of the noir part, all of the stuff with the police detectives is super boring.
Well, and which is another great connection to the Gialli. 90% of the time, the police procedural stuff is the part you don't care about when you're watching an Italian thriller. Or a slasher movie, honestly, that they try to throw that into slasher movies quite often too.
That's funny. I guess you're right then. Yeah, this could be if for someone who has more of a taste for Gialli than I.
Yeah,
then
perhaps I think
police scenes are work better.
But definitely the Euro sleaze thing. Like, this feels like the movie that let Jess Franco know he could, like, let his freak flag fly, you know. And then Jess Franco just bleeds into everything after that, because he runs away from Spain and he makes movies in Germany and France and Italy and everywhere. So you can't have just Franco without this movie is what I'm saying. But yeah, so unless you have anything else to say about this, we can move on to the next movie, which is Peeping Tom.
Yeah, let's go for it.
Which this one, instead of being a case of people trying to justify this being a horror movie, this was a case where it actually ruined someone's career and was thrown under the bus. And Unlike Eyes Without a Face, which was just sort of not that popular outside of the country, this one was basically buried until, you know, certain cultural critics, people like Martin Scorsese, start coming out and talking about how important and good it is. It is a movie about a shy man in Britain, modern Britain, who is a photographer, and he helps produce film for major motion pictures and not so major motion pictures. And his hobby is filming attractive women as he kills them. And it was made by Michael Powell, who was just coming off a really long run of universally praised and beloved Technicolor movies that he had made with Emmerich Pressburger, like Life and Death of Colonel Blimp and
Black Narcissus,
The Red Shoes, just, you know, movies that like movies that you watch and you say, eh, this is too old and stuffy for me, but then you're just fucking into when you're watching them, and you're just, god damn, I guess they're just great. They're really good movies. I didn't used to be into Powell and Pressburger, but it's something happened when I became a grown up, I guess. And they're just the best. But for a long time, this was the only Michael Powell movie I'd ever seen, because it had this reputation as being this grotesque, disgusting, horrible thing that this once great filmmaker made and ruined his career and everybody hated. And then later it was like, well, actually, this was a movie that came out before Psycho and does a lot of the same things. And so then people wanted to watch it. And then when enough people watched it and it got a Criterion release, then it became an important film, is what I would say. Like Eyes Without a Face, there's a sort of documentarian thing going on. The fact that it's not a mockumentary or even really a found footage movie, because the film within a film is in the context of the film. But it's similar to something like Cannibal Holocaust, where you're watching footage of stuff you feel like you're not supposed to be seeing, and the camera is being used not just as the killer's point of view, not just making the audience implicit in the killing, but making them like part of the record of it. And I don't know when the first movie to use a killer's POV was. I think we looked into this way back in the first episode when we talked about proto slashers. It might have been something like Spiral Staircase or something. But that was a thing that became a mainstay for giallo and slasher movies going on. So it's recognized as a proto slasher in a lot of ways. But in other ways, it's also sort of a proto found footage movie, because I have a book called Killing for Culture by David Kirkus and David Slater that talks about the idea of death films and Mondo films. And this is the earliest movie they could discover that had some sort of snuff element, even though snuff wouldn't be coined until after the Manson family was supposedly found with videos of their kills. I don't know if that was if that was true or not, but that's sort of like the importance of this movie in that regard, I suppose. That's like the short version of that.
So I had not seen this film before preparing for this podcast. It was like one of those classics that I'm like, I like to tuck away classics and be like, you know, one day when I feel like I've seen everything, I'm going to break the glass and watch Peeping Tom. And so I broke the glass and I watched Peeping Tom, and I feel I should have watched it more, because it's so, I feel like, you need to watch this like 10 times for it's so dense. There is so much going on. The thing that's fascinating about Peeping Tom is that it really just works as a story about the characters. Like, the dialogue is really sharp, and as a sort of a feature length version of the second half of Psycho, where you're worried that Norman's going to get caught. Like, it's just good at wringing tension out of that scenario, and it's just well photographed and well acted and well directed. And the fact that it is like this super dense, provocative take on what it means to be an audience to view films is almost like, it's, you can't unpack it all on the first viewing. It's so unbelievably, it's just like, it's such an amazing film.
And it's a lot of the, for me, even like, because I saw this when I was much younger, when I didn't really care about theme, for me, a lot of that sort of feel of it is the fact that it looks just as beautiful as the Powell and Pressburger movies and just as stagey as those. But then it has this realism to the sets and the backgrounds. And that I think, and even, and then there'll be these films within a film that are handheld and very verite. But I think it's the mix of that sort of Oscar and BAFTA friendly Powell Pressburger look with these like seedy elements that the British public does not want to think about. The fact that you're making them look beautiful like that, I think makes it all the more disturbing, because there's not a lot of actual violence in the movie, or even blood for that matter. The way it was described for years, I thought it was just this gruesome shit show. I don't think it's any more violent than Psycho. I'm not sure. I mean, the blood is bright red when it does happen, but it's very seldom. I think it was really the psychological messages and the psychological feeling of watching something beautiful be kind of make you feel like a bad person for watching it.
And yeah, and it is also just like, it's almost like that Toby Hooper thing where it's just the vibes are so bad. Like we are, mm-hmm. we're very early on, we are given the full autobiography of why the character is this fucked up like murderer who gets aroused by filming women as they see themselves dying. like, which is just an insane premise for 1960 already. Mm-hmm. And then like the backstory of that, and especially just how effectively it's told. It's not a psychologist coming out at the end of the movie and being like, oh, it's called the transvestite. Like,
yes. And that, I have a note of that too. It's like you compare Psycho and Peeping Tom directly, and they're both dealing with then modern, probably now outdated psychological terms. And like, they were probably really super contemporary. Like they're actually both trying to sort of teach the audience things about it. But in Psycho's case, because the killer's identity is a secret, they just sort of spit out all the psychobabble at the very end.
Right.
And it's, I mean, and it's awkward but beautiful. But
let's be clear, Psycho is a masterpiece too. Yeah. Like it fits that film fine, but it is just like when you see the footage of him as a child being tormented by his right. father. Just even specifically the visual ideas that Michael Powell has there, where they pose for the photo, but it's out of focus. When the stepmom, you know, takes the camera and just stuff like that. Like it's absolutely stunning. It's not just the concept of let's tell this story through these, you know, old film reels, of him growing up. It's, he really thought about, exactly how that information is laid out. And because you have that POV kind of feeling, because you have that documentary kind of feeling from watching these film reels, you really feel seedy from watching just a child be tormented.
Yes. And that's actually Powell's own child, and he plays the doctor, and his ex or his wife at the time plays the dead body of the first wife. So there's a little bit of a little extra on the cake to know that it was his real life son. It's actually based on something called the Little Albert experiment. That's what people assume it was based on, which was a behavioralist, John P. Watson, essentially soft tortured a baby with stimuli to gauge his reaction. Like, what is the baby going to do if I put a rat here? What is the baby going to do if I put a fire here? And it, was one of those, you know, things that was considered important at the time, but, is now sort of like, yeah, we didn't really learn much from that. You know, like half of Freud's theories, you know, that's just the way medicine works, is that someone's like, I have an idea. Let's torture a baby.
Yeah.
And then, well, I did something terrible. This better be important.
Well, that's one of the really sad things about the main character of this film, is that he has that moment where he's like, I'm sure it helped people.
Yeah.
Where he's like sort of rubbing the giant sort of textbooks that came of these experiments. From 2021, if I look at this and I look at Psycho, I would say Psycho probably holds up a little better psychologically, if only because it doesn't go into such detail. And this movie is just so fevered and out of control. I don't know exactly the timing on how this was released in America and who saw it when, but clearly, you know, everyone always talks about the relationship between Brian De Palma and Hitchcock, but like mm-hmm. this movie feels like the way I watch a Brian De Palma movie and go, yeah, this isn't it doesn't really get the Hitchcock feeling because there's just all this other fevered, just over the top sexuality. And it's just, and he just reigns in zero impulses where Hitchcock is in like high control of everything. Mm-hmm. Like this movie felt like De Palma to me.
Well, and as one of the movies they bring up as one of the proto slashers, it's like in the 80s, you ended up with a sort of different style of, there's different kinds of slashers. And so, this feels like, even though the guy dresses nicely and lives in a nice place, this feels like the sort of sleazebag killers of something like Eyes of a Stranger or Maniac. Like, he feels like he has more in common with them, where we follow this grotesque person. We are supposed to pity him, just like Norman Bates. It's, of course, harder. Powell makes his job harder by, one, telling us he's the killer from the beginning, so it's not a twist. And two, definitively showing us that he enjoys killing people.
Well, not even just killing, but he enjoys, like, he is maybe the first killer in movies who's like, I have a grand plan. And when this is all done, everyone will know. I don't, like, in this case, he's not trying to be like Seven. Like, I've turned serial killing into art and I've created my masterpiece. In this case, his plan is like, I need everyone to know my story and how it ended here and why I do these things. But it's still like he gets a certain satisfaction out of, quote unquote, building his documentary in a way that is really distasteful. But of course, it keeps going back and forth between scenes like that and scenes where he is just the shy guy who the cute patient girl downstairs, you know, really thinks that she can help. And you watch those scenes and you do have that sort of conflicting, like, oh, can't they just, like, you've already seen him. Like, the very first thing you see is him murdering someone, but you're still just sort of like, oh, can't they make it work it out?
I mean, there's a lot of that in Maniac, despite, you know.
I guess there is.
The actors looking so different. Norman Bates freaks out so much so his killing instinct makes him basically become another person. And then he's ashamed and cleans up after it. Where instead of just dumping bodies, Mark is the killer in here, hides a body in a trunk and then positions himself in a place where he can film someone's reaction to finding the body. Which I suppose is a slasher guy thing too, isn't it? That's Jason Voorhees drops bodies all over the place in hopes of people finding him and freaking out.
That's Michael Myers posing. Laurie Strode's friend with the tombstone of his sister.
I feel like if you break down 80s slasher killers, there's like a grotesque guy, there's this sort of sympathetic mystery killer where it's like it turns out the killer all this time was this like nice person who you didn't suspect, which feels more psycho to me. Then there's like the supernatural guy with a mask on, and then there's just big brutish guys that are sort of like people taking Texas Chainsaw Massacre out of context. And I think that Mark, despite his appearance, fits the sleazebag kind.
Yeah. the funny thing about this is, so there's a story about like the making of Psycho where they really knew they were going into uncharted territory and they really knew that they were pushing boundaries and that this could all go horribly wrong. This was it was a movie that Alfred Hitchcock kind of had to finance himself to get made, and he worked with the television crew, so it was lower budget than a lot of the films he worked with, stuff like that. And then at a certain point, Bernard Herrmann's score came in, and they went, oh, okay, no, it works. It's fine. And the thing about Psycho is Bernard Herrmann's score is so powerful that even though there's actually a lot of very complicated stuff going on, if an audience member isn't thinking too hard, they always know what to feel because of what the music is doing. And so the audience themselves don't necessarily feel uncomfortable or felt like they've been suspended in some kind of ambiguity or something like that, because the act of watching the movie, you are constantly guided along by Bernard Herrmann's score. Peeping Tom is the exact opposite, where like at no point in the movie do you really feel you're on solid footing about how to feel.
Yeah.
Like it's so unbelievable that anyone thought this could be at all palatable, because yeah. It's like Hitchcock did not go this far, and Hitchcock was very worried and felt that like it was only when the music came in that he knew that he could get away with it and stuff. And even then, one clear influence this movie had on Psycho was that Hitchcock refused to screen Psycho for critics, because he's like, he saw what they did to Peeping Tom, no fucking way. And it's really funny to me that anyone involved thought that this was going to be acceptable.
Yeah. I mean, you talk about movies being ahead of their time, and sometimes that's because they were not reading the room.
Yeah.
But it makes it all the more incredible, honestly. Again, listening to commentary, which is Ian Christie is doing the commentary. Something that he pointed out that I had never thought of is that autobiographical elements, and that the idea that this can be seen not just as, like you said, a movie about how we watch movies, but the fact that Mark's day job is working on this really crappy sort of comedy. I don't think that we'd had, I don't know what you call that brand of British comedy, those really horrible ones before they had Carry On, the pre-Carry On sort of goofy sex comedies. He's making this horrible movie that he hates and he's not enjoying it. And he makes snuff films on his off time on the exact same sets, because those are the real art to him. and you just get the feeling you don't get the feeling. I was told by the guy on the commentary track, I should say, I'm not taking credit for that one, that this was Powell sort of complaining about the state of British cinema and the way he saw it, at least.
And there is at least a little bit of precedent in Powell and Pressburger's work when you look at films like Black Narcissus and Red Shoes. These are films about people with obsessions, and about, they have this sort of fevered, heightened reality. I don't know all of their films, so I can't.
No, but those two movies in particular.
In fact, I would, I think consider Red those, Shoes has influenced more horror movies than Peeping Tom, if only because Peeping Tom was so underseen for so long.
I think that both Black Narcissus and Red Shoes almost fit horror movie at least as well, if not in some ways better. Red Shoes is a movie I find very disturbing. I was not prepared for it the first time I saw it, because it had been presented to me as this sort of fairy tale thing. And then there's that very long sort of hallucination sequence that just feels like a nightmare. And then Black Narcissist has a lot of the psychosexual stuff going on too, that you see in here. And I don't know how controversial that was when it came out, but you don't have to look too carefully to read lesbianism into that movie, which was definitely not something that people were cool with in the 50s. That's part of me feels like watching these movies out of order years and years later, after way after even I watched Peeping Tom, they don't feel that different to me. Even though Pressburger wasn't involved in this one, it doesn't feel inordinately, it doesn't feel like it's way outside, like the way it was described to me for years as this just sort of like Powell went insane. And he did go insane in the way you were saying, that like, what was he thinking? How would people like this?
Well, the thing is, it's the difference between some people can only take breastfeeding in public if there's like a little modesty blanket. Mm-hmm. People can swallow the pill if you dunk it in like, this is the most beautiful art film with spectacular just unbelievable matte paintings and photography. And so then they can accept the sort of material that otherwise they might find distasteful. And this, like, Michael Powell just has both tits out.
Yeah. Yep. And it's going, isn't it beautiful?
Yeah.
This is
Michael Powell doing the reveal at the end of The Brood.
Yes.
And they're like, we're ready for you, Michael Powell. We love all of your previous work. And he's like, then look. And they're like, look. Oh, God.
Yeah. And I think you can also, and also a good measure of how much movies changed after 1960 is within 11 years, Hitchcock went back to England and made Frenzy, which is 10 times crueler and meaner spirited and more fucked up than this, I think. And I don't remember ever reading anything. I mean, I'm sure there was some people who are like, oh, I missed the old Hitchcock, but it didn't like have him chased out of the industry, you know?
No. I mean, I'm pretty sure that Frenzy was a very divisive film at the time. But I thought about Frenzy a lot as I watched this as mm-hmm. well, but it's just hysterical that it's like Frenzy came after, you know, literally 70s horror films had started.
Yeah. So this is like one of a couple movies on this list that is a vital, important movie only because it was discovered later. It wasn't very well seen at the time. Unlike Psycho, everybody can claim they based their movies on Psycho because everybody in the goddamn world saw Psycho.
Right. Like everyone in the world saw Halloween. Not everyone saw Black Christmas.
Exactly. Unless you have anything else to say about this one, we can move on.
No, we can move on. Psycho came out after Peeping Tom, right. But we're not going to go into detail about Psycho.
So yeah, that would have been the next one. So then we're going to skip over to June of 1960 and the fall of the House of Usher by Roger Corman, which I'm going to end up mostly calling House of Usher because that's what I always called it. I forgot.
That was the American title.
Okay, that's why I was thinking of it that way. But
there's a couple other films, I think, in this cycle that had like full literary titles in England and then just House of Usher. I always knew it as Fall of the House of Usher, but in America, it was just House of Usher.
Yeah. And this was something I almost overlooked when originally compiling this list, because I was really thinking about the Roger Corman post cycle, as they call it. I always think about the ones I like the best, and those came out in later into the 60s. I had not put together that the first of the series, the one that starts the whole idea, the one that gave Corman the clout to make more of them, came out in 1960. And that's another incredible thing, because I assume he started doing this in part because the Hammer movies, like this is going to be the first period piece we're covering here. I assume he did this in part because the Hammer movies were making money in both England and the US.
Absolutely.
But House of Usher, for how the costume drama aspects of it, in fact, I would say all the movies in the Poe cycle, they don't feel like Hammer movies to me, other than they share some actors and they're very handsome, because the Hammer movies feel like, I feel like, this is hard to describe, I feel like the Hammer movies feel like old men trying to give the counterculture what they think they want and sometimes succeeding, whereas the Corman Poe movies feel like a younger man who is not a part of that culture but understands it, giving them something they actually want. Because it's not, there are huge psychedelic moments and they get more extreme as the series goes on, but it's not particularly sexual or violent. It's not exploitative for the most part.
It's certainly got, you know, beautiful women and decolletage, but yeah, their
bosoms aren't heaving.
No, even later in 1964, he never pushed it quite as far as Hammer did. I think for me, one of the key differences is Roger Corman, Poe movies are all about mood and atmosphere. He viewed Edgar Allan Poe's work as being psychological and happening in the subconscious and not as literal. And so he always wanted to shoot on sets and he didn't want to shoot on location. He always wanted to use matte paintings. He always wanted to have a slight unreality to everything.
Right.
Whereas Hammer films, the sets are detailed in a way and lit in a way that they feel like real places. They use frequent exteriors of forests and things like that, connecting the stuff shot. I forget the name of the studio where they shot all this.
Ailing Studios.
Yeah. And they're plot driven. Is the real thing about Hammer films is they have wonderful moments and they have great images and they have great actors and they have atmosphere, but they are absolutely telling stories in a way that Roger Corman's Poe movies never really were.
I mean, Roger Corman's working off of poems effectively.
Yeah.
And Richard Matheson, the novelist known for I Am Legend, he wrote this script, and he also wrote three more, The Pit and the Pendulum, Tales of Terror, and The Raven. And he sort of he deserves a lot of credit for sort of setting a template for, with the exception, I would say, of Mask of the Red Death, the sort of template for the plots of these movies. My cat is making so much noise behind me.
Matheson is an incredible get by Roger Corman. I do think part of the reason you get Richard Matheson, who had made, you know, Hollywood films at this point, he adapted his own Incredible Shrinking Man novel.
Right, that was a big one for him.
And so, like, he was working on The Twilight Zone during the same time. I thought maybe we'd talk about it during City of the Dead, but another big thing that was happening, big influential horror thing that was happening, were shows like The Outer Limits and The Twilight Zone on television. I really think Matheson was just sort of seduced by getting to pay homage to Edgar Allan Poe.
Right, right.
Because he didn't get a lot of money for it.
No, definitely not.
It's a spectacular film. It's totally unlike anything Corman had made before. He had made, I think, a color film before. He made a Western. It was one of his first films that was in color. And I think the profit margins on that one are kind of why he went to black and white for for his career after that. And this is one of six movies that he made in 1960. So he made this. He made Ski Troop Attack. He made Battle of Blood Island. He made Last Woman on Earth. He made Little Shop of Horrors. And he made Creature from the Haunted Sea, which didn't come out until a couple years later, but he made it in 1960. And all of those movies are extremely low budget, black and white films shot from like 7 days, basically, was the typical Roger Corman schedule. And this was the departure point where he, you know, was pitching to AIP. He said, look, part of the reason these Hammer films are so successful are these spectacular production values. And because, you know, they have these properties, basically, they're in the public domain, so they don't have to pay for the properties, but they have these recognizable properties that they can exploit, like Dracula and Frankenstein and stuff like that. And so he was able to talk AIP into basically doubling their budget, or basically instead of spending $250,000 on a double feature, they spent $250 on a single film. And one third of that went to Vincent Price, who earns it, because Vincent Price is absolutely incredible.
Yes, and becomes a staple of the whole series. There's only one he's not in.
Before this, he was in House of Wax. Before this, he was in House on Haunted Hill, I think, is 59. You know, he was a horror star already, I think.
And with House on Haunted Hill, he sort of established his sort of campy, sort of tongue-in-cheek thing.
Yes.
Which he sort of gets more into as these movies go on too. He's pretty serious in this one.
But this would really define the kind of roles that he would be in. Those were films that were contemporary films that took place in modern day. William Castle films like The Tangler and House on Haunted Hill. And this is like, oh, this is what Vincent Price was born to do. He is the man who's so sensitive that you can't speak loudly around him. And if he tastes anything other than a cold mush, that he just breaks into hives because he's just so delicate. He's like absolute goth fantasy boy.
Yeah, the idea, I'm trying to remember, the idea is that the siblings who live in this crumbling house of Usher, they have some sort of disease that makes them hypersensitive to light and everything else.
It's this sort of thing that you look at it and you're like, it's the house of Usher is a metaphor, and this is true in the Edgar Allan Poe story as well, probably more pointedly there. It's the line of Usher. It's the family tree, basically. Mm-hmm. And it's sort of rotten to the foundation. And you get the idea that maybe there's been like some sort of incestual inbreeding sort of a thing happening where they just have these really bad genes because of it. And certainly the way that Roderick Usher and his sister interact has some of those incestual vibes as well.
Yeah, I suppose Corman is not hiding perversion but he's also not displaying. So it's a different, again, I think this is the kind of thing counterculture was more interested in. Like, yeah, they liked boobs, but I think that like people who want to go get high and watch a movie would rather watch something like, oh shit, do you think that he's fucking his sister? You know?
Well, I think Corman just wanted to do something different. Like throughout his career, when he had the opportunity to expand and to stretch his wings, he wasn't just a cynical producer who was chomping a cigar and he was not Sam Arkoff kind of character.
Yeah, well, it's worth noting it's something that some people might not get, because I didn't get for a long time, is that at this point in his career, he has some power, but Jim Nicholson and Sam Arkoff are still the leaders of AIP, and they're still the guys he answers to.
Yeah, he has a running deal with AIP where basically they give him advances so he can always get paid to make the next movie, and he just cranks them out so fast. But he liked, you know, he wanted to make movies cheap because that's how he got to make the next one.
Right.
He wasn't such an artist that he, you know, would sacrifice his career for it. But he wanted to stretch his wings. He wanted to try something new. He wanted to try different tones. He made, is it The Intruder? Is the William Shatner sort of a race baiting film?
Right.
Like that was like famously the one movie of his that lost money. And I really think that if he wanted to, AIP would have been very behind there being more boobs in this movie. If they would have been very behind there being more blood in this movie. They were certainly no strangers to that sort of sensational marketing. And Roger Corman himself was making, you know, movies and sci-fi films that were more violent than you would expect to see from like the late 50s. But I think he wanted class. Like, I think that was the attractive thing. He had a genuine love of Edgar Allan Poe as an author. He had for a long time. And he wanted to do these stories justice. And that's the thing, is they certainly have to expand in the case of stuff like Pit and the Pendulum, and especially later films like Mask of the Red Death. You have to expand it to make it an actual plot with characters. But they are interested in honoring the stories they're telling, even if something like Haunted Palace, where the story they're telling, they don't get to market it as that story.
it's technically not a Poe story. It's a Lovecraft story.
So Fall of the House of Usher, it was still made for its day, you know, pretty quick. I'm going to go ahead and say Hammer films were not being made for $250,000 on a 15-day schedule. But under those parameters, it was sort of a work of passion, and it was profitable enough that he managed to, you know, really explore that. We were talking about the psychedelic thing. The funny thing about that is the word psychedelic would not have been in anyone's mouths in 1960. Roger Corman was getting to that kind of visuals because he was in psychotherapy. And he was trying to, as an artist, sit there and say, how do you represent the inner workings of the mind? And, you know, I think at this point you had like Hitchcock's Spellbound had been made, and there certainly had been other very surreal dream sequences in movies.
Vertigo.
And I do think, I love the way that Roger Corman does in all of his movies, very cheap, but very effective sort of psychedelia, where it's just a matter of dyeing the print a different color and, you know, shooting in slow motion. And, it really is less is more. It's not like a lot of kind of crazy edits and like the kind of stuff you'd get to later with The Trip.
And this he's on the commentary track, and he talks about how hard it was to sell simply because it wasn't schlocky, and that he talks about making it for the theater market instead of the drive-in market, and that he had to sort of trick Arkoff. Him and Price both relate the story where he told Arkoff that the monster, because Arkoff wanted a monster, he said the house is the monster, to get Arkoff off his back, basically, which Price did not understand as a concept, and that isn't really that much in the movie. It's really, like you said, it's the family line that's the monster. It's the psychology of the situation. But the thing to me watching it is how strange it is that it's the first in the series, because it is a smaller scale one, obviously, but it also feels like the one that the guy makes after he's already had three or four hits and is like telling his producers, like, look, I can make this pondering, emotional, mostly dialogue driven horror movie and sell it and make money, because he did sell it and made a lot of money, and that's why he got to do more of them. But it feels more like the one you make after the other ones that are flashier have already come out, and the other ones are flashier. This is, I would say, this is the least flashy of the series, other than maybe Tomb of Lygia, which is the one that's all shot outside,
yeah,
in actual sets or actual locations, and doesn't really feel like the other ones to me when I watch it.
So the thing about this movie is they bought all like stock sets and scenery and stuff from Universal for $2,500. And they just sort of had to keep redressing the same pieces to make, this is now a hallway, now it's this room, now it's that room. But when they made the next one, they kept all of the stuff they bought, and then they bought $2,500 more. And so that's why things get sort of more expansive and mm-hmm. the production value gets greater, even though the budgets didn't really change. Because again, they were not in the business of chasing after a lavish sort of film production. They weren't necessarily trying to top themselves that way, the way Hollywood did in the 30s. So it was more just like they just were thrifty, and that was sort of Roger Corbin's one of his main geniuses, yeah, was just how do you make less more? I love Vincent Price in it. I think, again, I just think this particular kind of role and this era became like the definitive Vincent Price thing, and he would be wearing sort of ruffled shirts for the rest of his career.
A persnickety villain.
Yeah.
There's a great, my favorite thing in the whole movie is Mark Damon plays this man who is betrothed, I guess, to Price's sister, who comes, and it's basically there's four people in the whole movie, and it's three of them for most of the movie. And it's sort of a love triangle between the brother, sister, and this guy who has no idea what's going on. And there's part towards the end after Price's sister has succumbed to, she has like a sleeping sickness type thing, and Price has buried her in the family tomb, even though she's not dead, and Damon figures it out, and Mark Damon grabs Price, and Price does this perfect don't touch, he actually says don't touch me, but he doesn't need to, because everything about his reaction to being touched is like a little, like a 5-year-old when they don't want you to feed them broccoli or something. It's just this perfect cringe, like no kind of motion with his body. I love it.
That was always the thing about these movies, is there would be the Mark Damon type character who is just like super generic handsome dude who shows up and is like the quintessential TV actor, which is just mm-hmm. like you should be holding a rifle and riding a horse and being interchangeable with 100 other guys on these Western yeah. shows or whatever. And they're ostensibly the protagonist, but that's only because you can't really have a movie where the antagonist is the lead. That's how you get Peeping Tom. it is always just you just sort of endure the time you have to spend with the Mark Damon type. So when Vincent Price shows up, and his first appearance in this movie is spectacular, like the way the door gets thrown open and the camera does a quick move into his face. It makes that all the better. And that the guy shows up at the old creepy castle and is like, what's going on, is that's also the plot of Pit and the Pendulum. Mm-hmm.
Kill Baby Kill.
Oh, sure.
Black Sunday.
Yes. Black Sunday has a lot of the same feeling as this.
There's a lot of, back and forth inspiration between Bava and Corman that I find interesting, because they're making movies at the same time, but then Corman is so into Bava that he starts sort of bringing some of Bava's stuff into his Poe movies, and Bava, being inspired by the color in the Poe movie, starts working in color in his movies.
Seem more in conversation with each other than Hammer. Hammer just sort of is part of that world because Hammer's the thing that started it in the first place.
Right.
But Hammer doesn't really seem to take wider inspiration from any other films, except for maybe just in general recognizing looser social mores and being like, okay, we can have more nudity and stuff like that.
Yeah. And then, they eventually get into competition with other British studios, but they're not really even in competition.
And of course, the funny thing is that Bava's films were all being released by AIP as well.
Right. And in part, that sort of developed this relationship between them. And AIP tried to get Bava to come to America to make movies. And he just decided he didn't want to. He was too uncomfortable with working outside of Italy and speaking English and stuff.
Wasn't that one of the Dr. Goldfoot movies? Wasn't that him working in America, or was that shot in Italy?
I'm pretty sure it was also shot in Italy.
Okay.
I don't think he's actually ever shot a movie in America, as far as I know. And then, another, Mark Damon himself is another sort of Italian genre guy, because after this movie, he actually moved to Italy, and he actually became a distributor, but he appeared in Bava's Black Sabbath shortly after this, which is sort of Bava going, aha, Corman thinks he can do color. Check out what I can do with color. And then he started appearing in a lot of spaghetti westerns, including this gothic revenge western called Requiescant by Carlo Viviani.
Is Mark Damon the male lead in the Wordalac?
Yes.
Oh gosh, that's, of course, the Wordalac is also this plot as well.
Yeah. Yeah. They're all the same idea. That's part of the fun.
Classic.
And I think one more thing, and unless you have more to say, but one more thing I think is interesting about House of Usher is it is an American film made to appear like a British film. And then at the end of this list, when we get to City of the Dead, we're going to have a British film made to appear as if it's an American film. And I kind of like that trade-off.
Yeah, for sure. Especially
because we're actually not going to cover any of the British movies that were released this movie, I should mention.
No.
I didn't think any of the Hammer movies were particularly... Brides of Dracula is good, but I don't think of it as...
I do love stupid. Brides of Dracula, and I also really like Village of the Damned.
And Village of the Damned is a non-Hammer movie, but yes, that is a very important British horror movie. Jekyll's Inferno is okay. That's another Hammer one that came out that year. I was convinced that Curse of the Werewolf had come out this year, and it absolutely did not. So Hammer just didn't fit because it wasn't their breakout year, and it wasn't a year with any of their best.
I think you could do an episode on the pivotal films of 1957, though, and obviously Hammer would fit right in there.
Right. And also, this isn't the only... this isn't the only Roger Corman movie that came out in 1960. He also made Little Shop of Horrors, the original black and white non-musical version, which is almost the opposite end of the spectrum as far as still being a horror movie. But it's contemporary. It's a comedy. It's very in line with sort of what was hip at the time. It's black and white. It was shot for a penny. it's another funny comparison to realize that those were the two things he made. I can't remember. Was the Terror shot on these sets?
Not on these sets. The Terror was shot on the sets, I want to say, of the Pit and the Pendulum. There was another Karloff film.
Raven. The Raven.
Raven. It was shot on the sets of the Raven, at least for a couple days, and then they sort of had to go and run and shoot a movie around the footage they got over the 2 days that they had Karloff extra. The Raven, I guess, is another example of you get Boris Karloff in The Raven, and then the same year you get Boris Karloff in Black Sabbath. And that's an example of them sort of trading actors.
Right. Well, and then Black Sunday's breakout star was Barbara Steele, and she ends up in The Pit and the Pendulum a couple years
later. That's right. That's right.
So they were definitely sort of buddies without actually hanging out together too often. it was a cool relationship where you get fans of Corman saying that he inspired Bava, and he gets fans of Bava saying Bava inspired him. But I really think it was a back and forth between two guys that like to watch a lot of movies and like to borrow stuff from those movies. Neither guy was afraid to rip stuff off, and both guys love doing magic tricks on the cheap.
So. yeah, for sure.
And we're going to end things here for now. Stay tuned for part two featuring Jigoku, Black Sunday, and the City of the Dead. I should have that up and ready very early next month, maybe even the first, I hope. In the meantime, please visit the Genre Grinder website for some upcoming Blu-ray and even 4K reviews. And you can find me on Twitter at Genre Grinder or at Gabe M as in Matthew Powers, or visit the Genre Grinder Facebook for more. Black Lives Matter, and have a happy, safe, and hopefully COVID-19 free Halloween.